Welcome to the Neighbourhood Church. We're glad you've joined us today for our service here online. Fill out your Connect card. Let us know if there's anything you want info on or want us to get in contact with you. Just click the link, fill that out. We'd love to chat with you. Otherwise, we're heading into the auditorium where worship's already in progress.
There is singing at the ancient gates. There's a melody of ceaseless praise. Age to age, the sound. with my fear by the side of the road. Hear you speak, but won't let go. Fall to my knees as I lift my hands to pray. Got every reason to be here again. Father's love that draws me in. And all my eyes wanna see is a glimpse of you. All that.
So we're going to open up the front for anybody who needs prayer. Got some people who, or person who is here to pray with you. was a wretch. I remember who I was. I was lost, I was blind, I was running out of time. Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. From the far side of the chasm, you had me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide, left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owed, broke my chains, freed my soul, and for the first time I had hope. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into glorious light. You took my sin place, laid and tied my tomb of sin. You were buried for 3 days, but then you walked right out again. And now death has no sting, the blood of the Lamb. Thank you, Jesus, for the blood applied. Thank you, Jesus, it has washed me white. Thank you, Jesus, you have saved my life. Brought me from the darkness into His name, glory to His. name. Here at the cross was my blood applied. Glory to his name.
God, I thank you for every story in this room that can support what we were just singing. That you have met us, that you are meeting us, and that you are constantly making lives new. Thank you, God, that you have reformed my life, that you've reformed the lives of people in this room. And God, for people who are here tonight, who are still waiting for that touch in their lives, for that reformation of their situation, for the redemption of wrongs or hurt, I ask, God, that you would meet them tonight in a new, in a novel way. Jesus, we thank you for this time to celebrate what you've done and to anticipate what you're going to. And the rest of this service, help that just to be our heartbeat, help that to be our focus and our intention for the rest of what we're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Welcome back again. It's so good to have you here at our online service this week. Thank you so much for the ways that you give at the Neighborhood Church. And your giving is what enables us to do things like our kids' ministry. We have some cool stuff coming up, and it's because of faithful financial worship and giving that we're able to do that stuff. So thank you. It's time for our family news. We're excited to hear what's going on at our church. Coming up very quickly, September 28th and 29th, we are having baptisms. So if you want to be baptized, just let us know. You can fill out a Connect card or tell anybody that you're able to. Just get it out there so that we know you want to do it so we can baptize you. Also, if you're not wanting to get baptized, just come and celebrate. Come hang out. It's going to be a great weekend, and we always love seeing people take that step of faith. Also, groups have started. If you are not connected to a group yet, you got to get connected to a group. This is the lifeblood of our church, is being connected with each other in community and caring for each other. So please get plugged in. If you want more information, you can send a Connect card in, or you can talk to Pastor Jordan. His email is jordan@theneighborhoodchurch.org. Speaking of being connected, we want you to get connected. If you've just started coming to the Neighborhood Church, maybe it's your first, second, third weekend. If you started coming over the late summer and early fall here, we want to have some food with you. So October 5th and 6th, after the service, we're going to share some food and get connected. So come find out what we're about as the Neighborhood Church. If you got any questions that you want to ask us, it's a perfect place to do it. October 5th and 6th after services, we'll see you there. Coming up on October 19th and 20th and the 26th and 27th is our fall missions emphasis. So every fall, we like to take some time and we like to talk about missions that we're supporting around the world and give some specific focus to the missional aspect of the Neighborhood Church. So come on out and participate in that. And I would even encourage you to start thinking about that ahead of time, even with your giving, to see if there's anything that you could give to our fall missions emphasis weekends. On October 25th, from 6:45 to 9 o'clock p.m., we're having a family movie night. This is a really cool thing that Pastor Karen is planning, where we're going to have popcorn and juice and a movie for free. And all you have to do is show up, bring some family people with you. It's going to be an age-appropriate movie that will be decided later on. The only thing is that if you want to bring some money, you can give a donation. But otherwise, it's free, free, free. Come out, hang out with your family, and have a movie night on October 25th. That's a Friday night. Speaking of Friday nights, you might be thinking, well, what's going on with youth? On October 25th, 26th, and 27th, that weekend, the youth are going to Living Waters Camp for our fall retreat. So we want you to register. We want you to be signed up. If you need any information, you can email me, ethan@theneighborhoodchurch.org. This is for grades 6 to 12. It's always an amazing time, an important time for young people to build relationships with each other. So youth, if you're watching, make sure you're keeping that in your mind. And parents, get those kiddos registered. Also, with youth, we have a costume party coming up on November 1st from 7 to 9 p.m. This is our opportunity to dress up, get into our costumes, hang out together, and have a good time eating a bunch of candy and playing some cool, wacky games. It's the perfect night to bring a friend, and I encourage all of you youth from grade 6 to 12, be there. It's going to be awesome. With all of that said, we are going to start giving a warm round of applause for a welcome. You're not doing it. Everybody clap. Come on. We're going to clap for Pastor Jordan.
Good evening, everyone. How are you doing? Good. It's good to be here tonight. Let me get set up quickly. And we're going to continue in our sermon series, The Better Life. So I got this clicker. Hopefully I can keep up with myself tonight because I've never done this before. And let's just jump right into it. And so we're going to start just by talking about the culture that we live in. I don't think it's a stretch for me to suggest that we live in a culture that says, hey, look at me. Look at what I'm doing. Look at what I've accomplished. Look at where I'm going, right? In a lot of ways, we live in what one psychologist calls the selfie times. Google says that 90 million selfies are uploaded each and every day. And if you live with younger people, you probably go, that's it, right? Maybe there's more being taken. But a number of years ago, and by a number of years ago, I mean probably about 25 years ago, maybe even 20 years ago, the idea would have seemed ridiculous to take pictures of ourselves all the time. It just wouldn't have worked back then. Back then, things weren't really, there wasn't a whole lot of digital stuff happening. And so this idea of us stopping and taking pictures wasn't really a thing that we did. What we did was we had those cameras where we took pictures of people, right? And then you would take that little film in, or if you were like me, you bought one of those disposable cameras that you can kind of throw around and it doesn't break, right? And you would take it and get the film developed, and then you would get your pictures. And that's how it was. But we're living in times, though, where there's so much availability, whether it's on social media, whether it's on different platforms like YouTube, where we can broadcast ourselves, we can get our ideas out there, we could point the attention towards ourselves. And in a lot of ways, if I could be honest with you today, I actually like a lot of this stuff, okay? I think social media has been helpful to some extent. It's also been harmful to some extent, right? But there's a good side to it. I like getting updates. I like seeing my friends post selfies from time to time, right? It's good to see what everyone's doing. It's good to see kind of where people are going. It's good to see what amazing meal I missed out on, right? And, you know, social media has given opportunity for us to keep up with each other a little bit more that way. But different platforms, even like YouTube, have given us opportunities to broadcast our ideas and even in some ways have really furthered the gospel message in a lot of ways. And so I don't want to sound like the kind of person up here today who is like ranting against social media and different platforms, because I do think that they definitely can have their uses, and there's a side to all this that I really do like. But if we look at it critically, and maybe for the sake of our talk today, and you'll understand this a bit more as we get into the scripture, there are all kinds of problems that can occur, I think, when we just simply point the camera to ourselves. When we simply say, hey, everyone, look at me. When we start making ourselves simply what we focus on, right? And it's not just surface things. I think in a lot of ways, it's heart things. And if we're not careful, we'll miss the ways in which these things not only affect us out there, but affect us inwardly, affect our hearts, if I could say it like that. If it's taken to the extreme, and it's not just surface stuff, it literally can become heart stuff that takes place in a culture that is all about me, in a culture that says, look at me, in a culture that says, notice me, or celebrate me, or follow me. If we're not careful, we can almost lose a part of ourselves, I think, in the process. Philippians chapter 2, this is our text for tonight. Is there any encouragement from belonging to Christ? Any comfort from his love? Any fellowship together in the Spirit? Are your hearts tender and compassionate? Then make me truly happy by agreeing wholeheartedly with each other, loving one another, and working together with one mind and purpose. Don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble, thinking of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interests, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Bless the reading of the scriptures. And so the Apostle Paul is talking to a church in Philippi. He's in jail at the time, right? And he's asking them some questions, and he says to them, do you have any encouragement
from belonging to Christ? How many of you are encouraged from belonging to Christ? Anyone? Just hands, right? Yeah, I think we could all answer that. Yeah, we've had some encouragement. Anyone here ever received comfort from his love? Anyone? Maybe even in that worship time, you received comfort from his love. And I hope you did. I hope that's your experience. He says, anyone's heart been changed for the better because Jesus is in your life? And I think a lot of us would raise our hand and say, yeah, we get that. Many of us would answer yes to those questions. And so the Apostle Paul asks those questions and then says, in light of all that, make me truly happy by loving each other, by working together with one mind and purpose. In other words, live as the church in unity. Live in unity. Protect the bond of unity that the church should have. You see, the scriptures teach us that the best way for the church to live and represent Jesus, the better life, if I could say it like that, you know, boring on our sermon title, is a life of walking together in unity, isn't it? One body, but many parts. You see, the world notices a church that walks together in unity. You know what the world also notices? A church that is very divided, right? A church that fights with each other. A church that doesn't necessarily support each other, but it's against each other. But the church will notice a church that's united and that is together. You see, the Apostle Paul says it like this. There's one body and many parts, and each one of us has a function. Each one of us plays a role. You see, the eye can't say to the hand, I don't need you. The hand can't say to the foot, I don't need you, right? You know, if one of these parts were to not be there, you would notice it because the body wouldn't function to its full capacity. It just wouldn't work the way it was supposed to. It would be very noticeable if one of the parts wasn't there. And in the same way, the Apostle Paul says that's what the church is supposed to be like. Each person has gifts. Each one plays a role, and each one is important for us to go forward in full capacity. You see, each of us in the body of Christ has a role to play here, ensuring that we walk together in unity. You see, not divided, not against one another, not fighting, but in unity. You see, unity is beyond important for the church. It's important for us if we're going to live the better life, but it's also important because it has implications for what the world around us is going to see when they look at the church. And Jesus was on his way to the cross. And we have some of his last recorded prayers recorded, written down. And it's amazing what he prays. It's amazing what he thought was important. He didn't sit there and start praying about the horrific things he was about to face. He wasn't talking about, you know, all the, in everything that was going to happen to him leading up to the cross. But here's what he actually prays. This is one of the prayers we have recorded. He's praying for his disciples who he's going to leave behind on earth. But he also says this. He says, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. You see, Jesus, in the middle of that prayer, says, I'm not just praying for them alone. I'm praying for everyone who's going to believe in me. So everyone who's going to believe in me, if you believe in him, this is you, okay? And his prayer was that we'd be one. How one? Well, just as you're in me and I'm in you. Like he's talking about him and the Father's relationship. This is a closeness. This is a being together. This is unity if you've ever seen it, right? You know, a couple years ago, I was convicted with the thought when I read through this portion of scripture. I was convicted with the thought, how much time in my prayer life do I spend praying for the unity of the church? How often do I pray for church unity? I mean, for Jesus, it seemed to be a big deal. For him, it seemed to be one of the last recorded prayers that we have written down, something that he thought was going to be so important if the church was going to be effective. And I had to ask myself, how often do I do this? Do I ever do it? And at the time, I hardly ever did it. Now I've made it a part of my prayer life. But according to Jesus' final prayers, it's important stuff. You see? Any football fans here? Anyone? Okay, I put my team up there who had a better night. I see you there, Noah Husky. And I put my team up there because we had a better night the other night. But football is one of those games that when I first started watching it, I won't lie to you, I would watch it for the splash plays and for the big plays. I was looking for the receivers. I was looking at the running backs. I was looking at the quarterbacks making the throw. And that's literally what I watch for. If that stuff wasn't happening, I would say it's a boring game. And then as I started watching it more, I started to see what was happening in the secondary. I started seeing the plays happening on defense, and I started to get more intrigued by that. But lately, as I watch football, and maybe this is just the next step in my growth, what I'm actually paying attention to is what you're seeing right there on the screen, what's happening at the line. Because very often, the splash plays and the big plays are allowed to happen because these gentlemen set that up, and they allow that to happen. And I like football because it's so complex, because everyone has a role, everyone has an assignment, everyone on a certain play has to be in a certain place. If your assignment's blocking, you have to make sure to make your block. If you miss your block, the whole thing kind of blows up, and everyone's affected by it. And I think I use that illustration because I think this is what the Apostle Paul kind of gets at when he talks about the church and the church's need to live in unity, is that the church needs to be working together. We need to love each other if we're going to be in unity. Each one of us plays a part. Each one of us has something to do. If you're not doing your part, then the rest of us are going to suffer. If I'm not doing my part, then you're going to suffer, right? Each person plays their role. And so the Apostle Paul says this. He says, don't be selfish. Don't try to impress others. Be humble. Thinking of others is better than yourselves. Don't look out only for your own interest, but take an interest in others too. You must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. And so if we're going to walk together in unity, we're going to have to look at the example of Jesus. So how did Jesus live? What were his priorities? How did he treat people? What was it that he did? You see, I think it all starts with us learning to live with humility. See, one thing Christ modeled for us was humility, amen? So here's the definition of humility. C.S. Lewis. See, whenever I quote Lewis, I feel smart, okay? Because I think Lewis is quite smart. But Lewis said this. He said, true humility is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. True humility is not thinking less of yourself. It is thinking of yourself less. You see, humility isn't denying your accomplishments, okay? Humility humility is not being able to take a compliment, right? But it's to recognize that life isn't simply about you only. Your accomplishments should be celebrated. You know, you should be able to take compliments. Those things are great and they encourage us. But humility, I think, is to recognize that life isn't simply about you. And I like Lewis's definition here. It's not thinking less of yourself, but maybe it's just sometimes starting to think of yourself less and maybe thinking of people around you. Jesus tells this story in the book of Luke about two men going to the temple to pray. One of these people is a religious teacher who would have been respected among religious people in those days, and the other was a tax collector. And they both go before God, and they both utter prayers, and their prayers have very different thought patterns. You see, the religious teacher was so proud of everything he did. He was so proud of how he kept the commandments, of how he gave, and he even points out to God in his prayer. He points literally to the tax collector next to him, and I'm thankful I'm not like this tax collector, right? In his mind, he's so much better than him. In his mind, he's here, and that tax collector praying next to him is way down here. And so in his prayer, he's elevating his accomplishments. He's talking about how good he is, while the posture of the tax collector, the story tells us, is so much different. But he just kind of bows down. It says he beats his chest. He won't even look up, and he just pleads for mercy. And he says, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. Here's what Jesus said about the story. He said, I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. I tell you that this man, this tax collector, rather than the religious teacher, went home justified before God. For all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. You see, it was the tax collector. And tax collectors really did do bad things in these days, okay? No one really liked them, okay? They ripped people off. They did a lot of things that weren't good. But it was the tax collector, Jesus said, who went home justified because he recognized his sin. He recognized his need for mercy. He recognized that he didn't have it all together. He recognized that, you know, there was nothing for him to brag about in front of a holy God. And he literally approached God in humility and wouldn't even look up, the scripture tells us in Luke chapter 18. You see, when it comes to sin, there appears to be two categories. Number one, people who think that they're righteous and good. And number two, people who know that they're sinners and have missed the mark. And it seems that the gospel, the first step for accepting the gospel is to accept that you've missed the mark and that you've sinned and that you've missed the boat. And we see that the way that these two men approached God really said a lot about the condition of their hearts and how they viewed themselves in the presence of a holy God. And I believe God calls his church not to live our lives with selfish ambition and putting the spotlight just on ourselves and ambitions that make it all about me and see me and honor me and look at me and celebrate me. You know, don't just look out for your own interests, the Apostle Paul says to us, but take an interest in loving others too. Take an interest in loving others too. You see, the one thing the scriptures aren't saying here is it's not saying to neglect your needs. Don't hear that, okay? It's not saying don't work hard. It's not saying don't provide for your home or for yourselves. You know, the scriptures often talk about these things in a very positive and good light. But in this portion with church unity on the line, with the whole theme of it being the church coming together, the Apostle Paul knows that our hearts are gonna need to be challenged here a little bit. And I sometimes think in the culture we live in, we're going to be challenged even more sometimes on these things by Jesus' example. And that is to live humbly, not just thinking of me, but often we need to start thinking of us, of one another. And so if humility is desirable, then its opposite must be less desirable. The opposite of humility, of learning to think about oneself less, would be pride. Would be pride, wouldn't it? You see, pride will hurt your soul. The tough thing about pride is that it's difficult to see. It takes a real sit down. It takes a real check of the heart, a real looking inwardly if we're going to catch it. And even that alone sometimes isn't enough for us to see it. But you can't see it by simply looking in a mirror. It requires honesty and the examination of the heart, allowing God to do his work in us. And so is all pride wrong and is all pride sinful? Well, not necessarily. I've already said this to you. It's okay to be proud of your kid who succeeds at something. Celebrate that. It's okay to be confident in the gifts and talents that God gave you. That's okay. That's good stuff. It's okay to celebrate an accomplishment once you've completed it, right? Maybe you've graduated from something. Good on you. Let's celebrate. These are all good things to celebrate. But where pride goes wrong is sinful pride is an elevation of ourselves above other people, and it's also a denial that we need God, okay? That's where we go wrong. When we start to elevate ourselves above others and we denied we even need him, that's where pride goes wrong. So let me show you a few ways in which pride reveals itself to us and shows itself to us. Number one, there's just a straight out, I'm better than you pride. This is the attitude, remember that story I just told you about that religious teacher had about that tax collector? Exact attitude, right? I'm better than him, thank you God, I'm not like him. Thank you that I'm not like that. Thank you that I give this and I do this and I do this and I'm not like that over there. You see, what's interesting is that the Pharisee was likely oblivious to the pride that was in his heart. And pride's destructive, and pride is so destructive because it's not easy to detect. It's not always easy to see. And so sometimes in our pride, we can have this tendency to think to ourselves, well, at least I'm not like them. And do we ever do this in our lives? Think about that. Have you ever driven somewhere and saw something and thought to yourself, oh my goodness, just rolled your eyes. And maybe you didn't say it out loud, but maybe in your heart you felt superior. Or maybe you watch something and you check something out and you just, in your heart, you're like, oh, thank God I'm not like that. And you just had that feeling of superior in your heart. Even though you might not have vocalized anything, you knew that it was there and you were happy that you weren't like them. You see, I think that's a revealing of pride when we think we got it together and no one else does. You see, the gospel begins not with admitting how talented and how great you are. You don't come before Jesus for the first time and tell him how great you are, but the gospel begins with admitting that you too are a sinner, doesn't it? And that you've missed the mark, and that you too need grace just as much as anyone else. You also need grace. Number two, second way pride shows itself is sometimes we think to ourselves, I can take care of everything myself. I got this. Let's say it like that, okay? I got this. I got this. I got it. You know, I don't need help from anyone. I got it. And I think there's a pride that comes with thinking we got this sometimes and that we can take care of our own business ourselves. And it may seem admirable sometimes in our society, but in its root, it's usually pride that drives us to think this way. You see, I think one of the biggest indicators of this type of, you know, I got this kind of pride is simply this. Think about this. Do you rarely pray? That's the question I'm asking, okay? Do you rarely pray? Do you rarely pray? Do you rarely bring things to God? When you have something come up, are you thinking to yourself immediately, how am I going to solve this? How am I going to take care of this? Or do you bring it to God? You see, when you don't pray faithfully, your lack of prayers is sometimes you declaring that you don't need God, or that you don't think you even need to consult him on it. That you got this. You can take care of it yourself. It's going to be good. And I can sympathize with this because we live in a self-sufficient culture, right? That encourages you to take care of yourself, handle your own business. And so I understand sometimes the temptation to not want to bother people and not want to burden others and want to carry this myself. I got this. I can handle this. But, you know, this kind of pride can get us in trouble just as much as any kind of pride, can't it? You know who struggled with this kind of pride? If anyone knew this kind of pride, it was Peter the Apostle. The man who pleaded with Jesus. Jesus walks into a meeting with his disciples and says, you know, one of you is going to betray me. And the rooster's going to crow. And it's going to happen. And that's when you're going to know you did it. And Peter immediately jumps up. No way I'm going to deny you. I'm with you to the end. I'm going to walk with you to the cross. Almost like, I got this. I'm with you, Jesus. It's going to be good. And yet he denies him three times. We know the end of the story, right? And he hears that rooster crow. And he's humbled. And he recognized, maybe I don't got this. Maybe I do need God's help. You see, the cool part of that story is God didn't just write him off. God didn't just ignore him, amen? But God restored him. And God continued to use him and use him in a powerful way to take the church forward after that, right? It's not like God just wrote him off. And that's the beauty thing about God is he doesn't just write us off, amen? Maybe some of us need to hear that tonight, you know, that God's for you and he loves you. But humility starts with admitting our weakness and sin, being vulnerable, refusing to live in shame and covering up, but bringing ourselves to God, bringing ourselves to a friend. Maybe you need to, you know, open up to your spouse. Maybe you need to talk to someone, talk to a counselor or something. Sometimes we need the help of others, amen? Sometimes we can use the help of other people. And in a culture that's self-sufficient, sometimes we don't always go there. Number three, another way pride shows itself is when our greatest concern is to make ourselves known. We already talked about this a little bit. There's a tendency sometimes to want people to look over here, see what I'm doing, see what's happening. You see, if you look at the story of John the Baptist, who was tasked with the preparation of Jesus, preparing the way for Christ, John's friends come up to him one day alarmed because this man named Jesus over there, he's getting way bigger crowds than you, John. So many more baptisms than you. People are rushing to him for baptism. You know, just a few weeks ago, everyone was coming to you, but this Jesus is on the scene now, and everyone's going to him. Everyone's going to him for baptism. It's as if they're saying to John the Baptist, John, he's passing you. You're losing followers. You're not as popular anymore. You know, you're not getting nearly as many mentions these days. Let's look at how, am I pointing a laser at you? Let's look at how John replies to this. To this, John replied, a person can receive only what is given them from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I'm not the Messiah, but I'm sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine and is now complete. He must become greater. I must become less. The one who comes from above is above all, and the one who is from the earth belongs to the earth and speaks as one from the earth. The one who comes from heaven is above all, is above all. You see, everything good comes from my heavenly Father. You see, John's not insecure about this. John, this doesn't bother him whatsoever. This is the plan. This is what's supposed to be happening, right? Everything good comes from my heavenly Father. Everything in there is from God, and we can trust him. And John declared that in his words here, especially when he says, he must become greater, I must become less. You see, it's as if John is saying, all my knownness, my whole platform is simply a gift to be used to glorify him. And it's not about me. And I'm not going to make it about me. My being known is actually to make him known. He must become greater, I must become less. And John teaches us that life for those who follow Jesus isn't simply about building our reputations or, you know, our platforms, but we are to be about him. We are to be about his glory. It's as if John declares to us that my desire to be known doesn't own me. My desire to be known here doesn't own me. I'm not owned by my desire. You know, my purpose here is, yeah, some people know me, but I'm known to make him known. I'm pointing to him. And pride can be ugly, can't it? Right? Pride actually reduces us. Pride diminishes you. It makes you smaller. It makes us worse. It diminishes your capacity to admit what you need to admit, to acknowledge sometimes what you need to acknowledge, to apologize when maybe the thing you most need to do is apologize. Pride keeps us from hearing, I think, sometimes what needs to be heard. Pride diminishes our capacity to love and also receive love. That's why I think it's so destructive in our lives. And the tough part is that it's often difficult to detect, because you can't just look in the mirror and see it. Often you have to do a little heart examination to see what's happening. And God's going to have to help us with that. You see, an invitation to follow Jesus really is also an invitation to unfollow this thing called pride. It's just to walk the way of humility that we see in Christ. And so the Apostle Paul said in Philippians 2:5, your attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus. Well, what was his attitude like? Well, let's read it. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage. I didn't put the whole verse up there, so I'm going to read it to you. This is a way of humbling myself here, right? And rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above all names. You see, Jesus models it not by assuming the place of a king, not by assuming that he's up here and everyone's down here, but he came down to earth and met us on flat ground, right? He came down here when he didn't have to do that. And if anyone's supposed to be worshipped, if anyone's supposed to be celebrated, it would have been him. But yet he, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God. Rather, he made himself nothing, taken the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, even becoming obedient to death on a cross. You see, Jesus, for our benefit, made himself nothing and took the nature of a servant. He humbled himself to model how we are also supposed to live in this world, how we are to treat one another. And in the end, the Bible says that God exalted him, gave him the name that is above all names. And the scriptures say, in your relationships with one another, have that same mindset that you find in Jesus Christ. That we're not above anyone else, amen? That we don't always got this, quote unquote. That maybe an act of humility for us today is reaching out to someone, right? Reaching out to someone for a helping hand. You know, our greatest concern can't be to make ourselves known. You know, we want to make him known. And so, you know, we in our relationships with each other and how we live, we consult that same attitude that Jesus had. You see, at the end of the day, the gospel is really a threat to the proud and to the arrogant and to the self-seeker. The gospel is a threat to the proud and arrogant, but the gospel is joy. The gospel is good news. The gospel is beauty to those who are humble, to those who know they're in need. Amen? And so, in other words, the way to improve yourself is to focus not just on you, but on those around you. The way we can live the better life, it doesn't consist in simply our own power or our own pleasure, but in looking to the needs of those around us. You see, it's very counter-cultural and counterintuitive, but Jesus proved to us it works. Amen? And if we want to become the kind of church that God wants us to be, we must live humbly, and we must not ever allow an attitude to creep in where we think it's simply about me and what I want, but really, it's about looking out for one another. Amen? And so the better life happens really quickly here. I'm literally going to do this in a minute. The better life happens as we live selflessly, as we learn to live selflessly, as we recognize that this whole thing can't be about me because, you know, we need to be here for one another. The whole point of the church wasn't just to elevate, you know, one or two or three people, but it was so all people can benefit and grow in Christ. Number two, the better life happens as we value others and their needs. You know, life brings such fulfillment, I think. You know, and anyone who's helped someone understands this, that you even get something, like, you know, huge out of that transaction, right? You know, like, maybe it requires sacrificing and put something you want aside, but when you're able to come along someone and help them, what a blessing that is for you. And so the better life happens as we value others and their needs. The better life happens as we walk in humility, as we follow Jesus's example, as we model our lives on how he lived, which is a strong call. It's not easy. And we're going to need his help, and we're going to need to look to him. We're going to need to draw strength from him. We're going to need to be in prayer. We're going to need to be connected to him if we're going to live like that. And the better life happens as we live in unity. Amen? As the church lives in unity, we all play a role. We all have something to do. We all need each other. We are simply better together. You can't do life alone, right? God intended for his church to walk together. And so let me pray for us tonight. God, I just thank you for your word. I thank you, God, that it has the power to honestly, Lord, show us things in our lives, show us things in our hearts that we need to see, show us things that are difficult for us to see. Lord, as we come before you tonight, I pray that you just reveal things to us, Lord God, ways in which maybe we've made things a little too inward, ways in which we've tried to make things a little bit too much about what we want. But Lord, would you reveal to us in our hearts each day, Lord God, what it is that you desire and what you want. And may we live lives that please you, that look to you, and in doing that, Lord, we'll look to one another and we'll look to those around us. And so I pray for each one tonight, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts over this week, Lord God. Just give us opportunities in which we can love you and in which we can love other people. And help us to live as a church, Lord, always in unity. Just in humility, God, loving each other, Lord God, in the same way, Lord God, that you love us. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today at the Neighborhood Church. I hope your time with us was meaningful here online. Just encourage you to go out into your world this week and just remember that the better life consists in loving people and looking out for one another. We've had church. Let's go be the church. Have a great day.